welcome everyone, and welcome to our guest. Rosa has lost her voice, so she asked me to chair the meeting, and I told Bob Ray that I would entertain a motion to adjourn before we started, but
so moved.
First of all, we thank you for taking the time. I just want to tell a quick antidote. There was two educators who were talking and debating what is more important, learning or action. So, what is more important, learning or action? And it came after going back and forth to the conclusion that learning is more important when it leads to action. So, I know all of us have been learning quite a bit up until now, and I know that all of us are anxious to get to the action items of helping write our reports and get down to where the disparities and inequities are. And I thank you already for everything you are doing. We all thank you for everything you are doing in order to take our learning and put it into action. Now open it up to the other co-chairs, and we have forbidden Rosa to speak because we don't want her to get any more under the weather.
Actually, I wasn't planning on saying anything today, except I pity Rosa. I mean, I'm running into all these people who've lost their voices this week. Anybody else lost their voice? I mean, something's going on. Honestly, I haven't lost mine. I hope, I know that we have a strict agenda, and by open meetings laws, we publish that agenda, and we should stick to that agenda. At the same time, we've got things going on in our community over the past week that if we don't talk about tonight, we need to talk about at some point. And that's what I'm really concerned about, things that I think this group should have known about, but we didn't know about, at least two or three things. And I hope we can get to it at some point. I'm not really ready to blow up the agenda, but at some point we got to talk about some of those things. So with that, I'll shut up.
Thank you very much, Robert.
I'd just like to thank everybody for being here. And once more, don't lose focus on the great work that we're doing as a task force. I think that we are focused on the right things. I would agree, though, things keep happening that fit into one of the categories that we're looking at or the other. So just stay focused. That's the only way we're going to get this done. And we just need to qualify the things that we're looking at and keep moving. Just keep moving forward.
Thank you. I believe that everyone received the minutes from the February 19th and February 26th meetings in their emails. If there are any corrections, we will entertain it at this time. If not, I will accept a motion to accept the minutes as received.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Motion passes. Thank you. We now get to number four of our agenda, and that is update on public engagement, and we hand this over to Michelle and Estrus. And thank you already ahead of time for updating us this afternoon.
On March the 8th.
Michelle, Catherine might be just in case. In the media, later.
On March the 8th, we held our second citywide town hall. We had 123 people attend and talk to the task force members. Thank you to everyone who is able to make it. We're now completing a final report that will include the comments from the community conversations, the continuing the conversation meetings, which we had 14 of those, and the final city hall, I mean the final town hall meeting, and we'll be getting that to you all probably by the end of the week. So does anybody have any questions? For right now, the meetings are kind of at a holding pattern, and I think our thoughts are that once we have that draft plan, it will be another opportunity to go out and engage the public and get their thoughts on some of the disparities that are identified and also maybe some preliminary recommendations.
What Michelle said.
One thing we did, as you know, we did the town hall meeting live. We had it streaming on the website, and we also have that file uploaded. It's on YouTube, and it's on the One Fort Worth website.
Thank you. And the website itself is excellent. There's all sorts of documents on there, are the files of meetings. If anyone asks any of us where we can get information, that is a great place to send them. Okay, we can move on to update on assessment of disparities in municipal services, and Linda Johnson, we thank you as well.
Provide you with a quick update on our work with NLC as they're looking at some of the disparities in municipal data. As you all are aware, all city departments submitted a survey on the data that they currently disaggregate by race. And after that initial review, NLC identified four departments that they wanted to further look at. Their data sets, that's municipal court, economic development, which is the MWBE program, neighborhood services, and the police department. So they've done some initial review of the data. We do not have any of the results of their review yet. But last week, two of their members, Ariel Guerrero and Chelsea Jones, were here to visit with six departments, the four that I just mentioned, plus library and traffic and transportation. They were here to put a little context around their data so that they were interpreting it right and understanding it. They also wanted to discuss some of the current data challenges that departments have in identifying the various opportunities to collect and disaggregate some of their data by race. So they asked departments, you know, how they currently, they wanted to better understand how departments use their data to measure their services and then the challenges they're having with collecting that data. So in mid-April, they will be submitting a report to us, which will show their data analysis of the data that they looked at, and also they'll be providing recommendations to us on how we can improve the infrastructure and processes we have that will help support us further disaggregating data within these departments.
Thank you. Are there any questions? No? Thank you very much. Now go to a update on leadership training, and I hand this over to Fernando.
Thank you. You'll recall that when the city council created this task force on race and culture, the council assigned three basic tasks to the task force. Those tasks included convening a series of healthy community conversations about race and culture, also analyzing disparities in the delivery of municipal services with respect to race and culture, which we have expanded to include a wide range of topics relating to quality of life. And third, to advise the city manager and the city council on training for city officials about race and culture. And this task force decided that we should provide broad oversight over that process and expand the audience for the training to include not only city officials, meaning elected officials, appointed officials, city department heads and assistant directors, but also community leaders and interested citizens. And I'm going to ask in a moment Estes to talk with us a little more about outreach to community leaders and what that might involve, because I think it warrants further discussion. But if you look on tab number one in your binders, the red tab number one, you'll find what we call an informal report, an IR, to the mayor and members of the city council. It actually appears on the in the packet for tomorrow's city council meeting, which just went out late last week. And it describes the entirety of the leadership training process that we propose to undertake in the next few weeks. And so you can see the schedule appearing on page 3 of that written report. You'll see dates for the city council appointed officials and assistant city managers. That's one group. They would have 3 training sessions described as Leadership 101, 201, and 301. The same training opportunities would be provided for department heads and for assistant directors of city departments. All of that training would be delivered by the National League of Cities on the dates that are indicated. In addition, Ezra Tucker has contracted with us to deliver training for community leaders and instant citizens, and has provided a large number of dates when that training or engagement would be available. And so I'm happy to entertain any questions, Mr. Chairman, about training for city officials, and otherwise I'd like to turn it over to Mr. Tucker to describe the engagement of the community.
Are there any?
Can I ask a question?
Sure, of course.
I don't see any follow-up. Maybe we have follow-up.
Follow-up to the training?
Yes. I mean, it doesn't just happen over a day's time. It takes some time to do these things.
Yes.
You're going to make them familiar with it the first time around.
There will be 3 all-day training sessions.
Okay.
3 all-day training sessions, at the end of which, you can see, the schedule appears on page 3 of 3.
All right, got it. Okay.
And by the end, and the description of the sessions appears on pages 1 and 2, Leadership 101, 201, and 301. I can go into that description, those descriptions in greater detail if you wish. But the idea is that having gone through this training, city officials, from elected officials down to department heads and assistant directors, will be more aware of disparities and how those disparities can come about, so that we might work to reduce or eliminate them and be more conscious about how we go about delivering city services to our residents in a way that's not only not discriminatory, but is equitable, so that the services are delivered in accordance with the need, not necessarily in an equal fashion to all segments of the population.
As we go through these trainings, we are confident that the National League of Cities have had results where they've done this in other places.
They've come to us highly recommended for that reason.
Okay, but my question was, have they been successful? Have we seen success in other places?
We'd be happy to get information for you. That's a valid question. We'd be happy to get information about the results that they've achieved in other cities. I'm told that they have achieved good results, but I need to provide you with some substance behind that answer.
So your question is more around track record? What's the track record?
Yes, ma'am. We're hiring them. They've been here from day one. And so I've asked the question before, and what is their track record, their success rate? Have they been successful, and has been successful in a municipality like Fort Worth? And did they face some of the same conditions that we're facing right now?
I think that's a valid question that we need to follow up.
We'll follow up with LC. We're happy to provide that information.
And I think just to add to what Walter mentioned, how do they measure success?
Right.
What is that being measured by?
It seems very obvious to me why we want city officials to take this training. When we say interested citizens, what are we talking about? I can think of a list of people I think would benefit from this training. I'm not sure any of them would sign up for it. And that's my question, is how do we reach who are the interested citizens we're going after and why? And how do we get most of the white population of the city to take this training?
I can tell you how I interpret that. I interpret that of people of influence.
As what?
People of influence. People who, once they're trained, they can go out and influence others. Is the way I interpreted that when I submitted the names that I submitted. People have to buy into what we're trying to accomplish. And one way to get buy-in is to invite people to the conversation. And we're not going to get that group of people in a town hall. We may not get them in a community conversation. But with a personal invitation from some of our elected officials, we might get them to come and engage with us.
So, following up on that, if I make a list of recommendations of interested citizens I think would be interested, the invitation would then go to them from our elected officials?
Yes, from the mayor, as I understand it.
Is that right?
That is our intent. And I don't want to steal any thunder from Ernestus. Our intent is to have, as you can see in the written report, we will have training for community leaders, and we'll have training for instant citizens. The instant citizens could be anybody who is interested, who expresses interest, whether they've been identified by the task force or the city council or not. So any resident of Fort Worth who would like to participate in the community engagement is welcome to do so. All they need to do is sign up. Now, for the community leaders, the recommendation, again, Estes will explain it. The recommendation he gave to us at our last all-day work session was to have each task force member nominate three individuals in the community whom we would invite by means of a letter from Mayor Price to participate in one full day or two half-day training sessions about race and culture. And similarly, we would allow any interested citizen to register free of charge for the same kind of experience. In addition, and ordinarily I would ask Ms. Navajar to comment, but not tonight because she's not able to speak. But she took the initiative last week of reaching out to Mr. Matt Rose, the chair of the NSF, who has agreed generously to convene a dozen or so diverse CEOs in the community to engage in a facilitated discussion about race and culture. So it's important to reach out to folks at in decision-making positions. It's important to reach out to folks who are not otherwise going to become engaged. We understand that need. And for that reason, we're asking each task force member to nominate people. Some of you have already done so. And if you give us more than three, we're happy to accept more than three. And we're also asking the city council members each to nominate up to five citizens for the same community engagement. But I'd like for Mr. Tucker to explain our objective so that you'll be able to understand better how this process relates to the overall purposes of the task force.
Just two things before we turn it over to Esther's. One is there's also the possibility of us extending, as Rosa just whispered, an invitation to all those who came to the community conversations to continue their participation in these community conversations. And second, we have guests here who are here almost every month, and you're more than invited. We would love for you to be able to participate not only as observers, but as active participants. So if this is something that you're interested in, please let us know. We'd love to have you as well. I'm sorry.
I really appreciate all the work that's being done and the fact that you've got all the training and everything set up, and you're actually looking for additional committees to be set up to look at it. But we also have on the table, we'll have on the table the things that we already know about. And the biggest change, not having another committee meeting or anything, the biggest change is how the city council looks at this and whether they're willing to make changes in their and their services, their policy, and their philosophy. That's what it boils down to.
Absolutely. And may I add on this, and not to cut off Estrus and let him talk, but I know once he starts talking, I'm going to be able to cut him off. I don't know who all got my email from last week, but I'm in agreement, I think, with Walter and something Corey said a couple of months ago. I think we need to hear from the business leadership for sure, because without the business leadership buy-in on whatever we recommend, nothing's going to happen. At the same time, I was concerned, and I raised this at our co-chairs meeting the other day, asking business leaders of the ones we know to sit in a training session for a day is not helpful. Because first of all, I don't think they would come to that. Number two, and if they did, I'm not sure what we'd get from them. In my mind, the best thing that we can do is something I think, Corey, you recommended a while back, is not necessarily have them come here, but once we come down with our findings in each of these categories, invite those that Matt Rose and others may bring onto us and sit them down, not for a day, but for an hour or two. I mean, if they're great business leaders like we think they are, we present to them our findings and say to them, how do we solve these issues? Can you help us? And again, giving them a chance to respond in that manner. And I realize National League of Cities, Estrus, they have this template in trying to get people to think positively and objectively about some things. At the same time, I think, as someone said a minute ago, we're at this point where we're winding up our fact finding and we're ready to get the solutions. I want the business people to help us with the solution, even if we don't agree with them in the final setting. But when we finally submit something to the city council, we can say we at least we presented it to some business leaders, some other community leaders. And I guess that's where I'm from. I know that this came up at our all-day meeting, and I wasn't exactly aware of what we meant by training session of business leaders. So I'm just concerned that we're at a point now that we're ready to move to recommendations and then involve those stakeholders in our community to buy into it. That's where I am. I'm just wondering about whether or not this is necessary at this point.
I wanted them, business leaders, like you said, Barbara, to come and tell us what they've done and what they intend to do, to have them on record. Those are the employers. So that's what I want to know. And the training, the session, who trained these trainers? Who trained them?
For the one proposed for the community leaders training. So I'm the trainer. And I can give you kind of a list of credentials. I've been training and facilitating for a long time, so I can give you my credentials. But I'm the one doing the community leaders and interested citizens track, and then we can ask for the same thing for NLC.
What's the process of training these business leaders to do what's right?
Oh wow!
That's what I want to know. What's the process of training them to do what's right? And okay. Go ahead.
How long do I have?
Let me just before you go. First of all, I'm not sure we are training CEOs. I think if we can educate and enter a discussion, that might be a better term of what we're trying to do. But also, yes, without doubt, thank you. To know what they are. I'm being part of I'm trying to help bring out Rose and conclusion here, but also to know what they are doing. So I think we have to understand our expectations before we go in and say, okay, we're going to train you. You do this. You do that. Because I think that we need that, we talked about wordsmithing. We need to have our wordsmithing down before we go into those expectations. But we'll let Estes go to that. But beforehand, on behalf of all of us, Estes, we want to congratulate you on being the interim director, executive director of the Center for Courage Renewal. We congratulate you, and we know that you'll do a great job there, and we are blessed to have you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Professors, if I may interrupt on behalf of the Navajo, we've asked you to say a word. And Estes will elaborate, but Ms. Navajo and I met last week with Mr. Rose, and it is not about training the CEOs. It's about engaging them in a discussion involving the leadership of this task force as well. I have to say, Mr. Rose was rather pointed, to use his example, in citing some of the disparities that he sees in the community with respect to race and culture. If you're not familiar with his background, he and BNSF were among the founders of the of North Texas League, which is a program aimed at promoting minority executives in local companies. They saw a need roughly 20 years ago, and BNSF took the lead in bringing corporate CEOs to the table with, at the time, Mayor Kenneth Barr and others who saw that, that Fort Worth needed to provide more leadership in promoting minority executives. That organization is now led by Gina Bivens, who happens to serve on the City Council. And they've done, I think, meaningful work over that period of years. So I'm simply citing his credibility.
I don't doubt his credibility, but a CEO, I want to know what he's done.
No, he's
personally in his business, and I don't intend to be a thorn in Mr. Rose's side.
No, he would be happy.
What he's done, and
I'm sure
what he would like to see.
I'm sure
that's
that
what I'm hearing from all of them.
I'm sure he will be happy to do that. As would, and we could ask the other CEOs similarly to respond. He took the initiative to point out that Fort Worth was a major problem. This is his opinion, and I'm going to do my best to characterize it. Rosa, you can kick me if I misstate it. That the perception of Fort Worth among CEOs across the country and among minority executives who may want to come to work for BNSF and other local companies is not what it should be. That relative to Dallas, this is the example he gave, relative to Dallas, we're perceived to be something of a backwater. We're not seen as progressive. He said he doesn't have any facts to corroborate this perception, but he says this is a perception that he sees widely across the country. That Fort Worth has a low profile, and that's consistent with the finding of the recent Economic Development Strategic Plan. We have a low profile. We're the 16th largest city. We're perceived to be the 45th largest. We have a very low profile, and to the extent that people think they know about Fort Worth, that's often not accurate. And the perception with respect to the extent to which we welcome diverse executives, the perception is negative. We're not perceived to be a welcoming community. That's the perception that Mr. Rose described to us, that we have a lot of work to do. And that among the factors that he sees as underlying that perception that makes it difficult for him to recruit minority executives to BNSF, that among the factors are education, that our public education is not up to par, and second, public transportation. He says that many minority executives draw conclusions about the progressive character of our community by the quality of public transportation. And those are the two factors that he cited, education and public transportation. And he said that he has experienced some degree of frustration in trying to recruit minority executives to Fort Worth, not necessarily to North Texas, but to Fort Worth, because of that perception that we are not welcoming to minorities. Now, we can agree or disagree about the validity of that perception, but that is a perception that he has observed. And he wants to lead a discussion among other CEOs about the perception and the reality of diversity in Fort Worth. So eventually we're going to let Esther speak.
So I've revised it 12 times while I'm listening, but it's all very, very good. And so just let me just name, and I jotted down, Corey's question, Katie's question, Walter's questions. Those are powerful lenses to look at this work and the plan. And I'm going to respond to it in a kind of overarching way. And if I could highlight or summarize what Fernando just lifted up from Matt, and some of you said, we're trying to create a space for buy-in, right? So what that CEO, what that leader said is powerfully aligned with so much of the data of disparities, some of the feedback coming from subcommittees, some of the overarching assumptions that many have in this space, and not every CEO is going to touch that. Some CEOs will say the opposite of that. So it's not just about picking and choosing any level of business or community leaders. You want the buy-in. So you can't train a CEO or a community leader or an interested citizen to do the right thing. You can create a space where honesty and goodwill and a commitment to the common interest of our city collectively is wealth. And then invite people to show up. That's a core of what these was framed as community leadership training, what's listed as community leadership training. That's the core of it. So it's not about training adults. Adults don't train well to change behavior. A lot of our assumptions, as reflected in community conversations and in some of our deliberation, we have some ideas and concepts that we think are powerful, and often they are, and we know some people that need to sign up for it, right?
We do.
And somewhere in this small world, there's a course that somebody thinks you need to sign up for, right? But the truth is, that doesn't bring out our best. So these processes rely upon incentivizing and inviting. Coercion won't work. Making someone or cornering someone won't work. They've got to feel the need. They've got to relate to it in a way that they can respond honestly. And if we have five people who are responding honestly from their lived experience, from their ideas and their commitment, we can get more done than 50 people who are just showing up and are not really committed. Okay, so I had to frame it like that because of all the rich conversation. So let me remind you of a metaphor, and I'm not going to be long, I'm almost finished. Remember the metaphor we offered the first day? It feels like somebody's even behind me because it's just, I want to do this. The metaphor of the elephant and the five blind men, do you remember that?
Yeah.
Five blind men interacting with the elephant, depending upon the part of the elephant that they were examining. Each of them having a different part, each of them naming what their experiences were. That's what we're doing. We're living into that. And the solution can't be advocating one part against the other. The kind of racial and cultural equity plan that Fort Worth deserves based on these our voices, your voices, is one that's inclusive of those five perspectives as an illustration. So how do we, in a sense, paradoxically, build on the different vantage points and insights that you're naming? Not either or, it can't be one or the other. We've got to find ways to integrate and to blend our learnings and our perspectives for a set of recommendations that advances racial and cultural equity. So the first thing I did was to reframe this from a community leadership training to community leadership engagement. We're not training adults. We're creating a space where they can share their perspectives and lived experiences and together co-create something that moves towards solutions. And I love your opening quote about learning learning is more important when it leads to action. These engagements have to point toward action. The recommendations that are emerging in your subcommittees are some of those actionable areas. The second piece is incentivizing, and that's where these recommendations, these nominations come from. To nominate people, not just someone off a newsprint, but someone you have ideally some connection with about their lived experience, about their leadership relationships and capabilities. And that goes a long way. Some of them may not be able to make a given date, which is the next part of it. We try to frame a flexibility of dates, recognizing, as Bob Red said, a whole day can be challenging. So we've got several scenarios of half days. We've got a whole day starting in the afternoon and going in the late evening. We've got weekends. We have weekdays. There won't be a perfect menu to reach everybody we think should come. Some will choose not to come. Some calendar won't allow them to come. But we've laid out a diverse menu of optional dates to involve them. Okay. So I just ran through 10 other things I could say that I'm not going to say. But let me just say this. That the quality of training that goes on with the leadership, the city leadership training, and we've looked at it, there are elements, in answer to Walter's question, I don't know all their content, but there are certainly elements of this that relate to best practices in cities similar to Fort Worth that have had some measure of success. I can't say all the details, but just what I've looked at.
Something that was sent to us, it was San Luis, Portland, and a couple of other cities were used as examples that I think similar
process. Seattle. I pulled those down from cities that I had been to and that NLC had done some work. So there are some correlations. We'd have to get a little bit deeper to get to what Walter was lifting up, but I think that there's some potential evidence of efficacy with some of the practices and trainings. But I think the real key is that we're trying to cultivate common language and shared understandings on both sides so that we can talk and engage across the spectrum of community and business leaders and city leaders around practices and strategies that advance racial and cultural equity. That's the intent and that's the purpose.
I would just add to that that given the economic development work that Mr. Stearns and his group have been doing, this is a perfect time to talk to Matt and Mike Berry and all of those individuals, because what's important to them is important to us, is the economic growth and sustained growth, bringing in big businesses to this community. And so while they may not have targeted some of the things that we have, what's important to them is important to all of us. And what's important to us, it has to be important to them. So I think the economic study that's been done and all of the things that came out of that should drive their engagement into this work. And I believe that it will. I really do.
She said that Matt said that he's always wanted his workforce to represent to represent the community as it is, and he wanted that to be stressed. So I think that's a positive.
He's always stressed that from day one that I met him in 2001, is that he wants the workers there to be in a separate resemblance of the communities of where his corporate office is located.
So thank you.
So Fernando, what you're saying is that Fort Worth has an image problem.
The big image problem. Robert Sturbs. Who has an image problem?
Where are those people that created that image? Where are the people that created those issues? They should be a part of this.
Yes.
this as well. And I know Fort Worth, we have a, there's, I guess the state appropriates so much money for you to put a big sign out on the freeway that says, welcome to Fort Worth. So maybe we should have some influence on what goes on that sign and not where the West begins. The West begins where the East ends. Not nothing like that. But establish 1849, reestablish 2018. All are welcome to Fort Worth. And just something simple. You know, we don't keep the bomb horn. Everybody here doesn't have a truck. I do. We got two, but you know what I mean? So I if we're going to do the image, it really needs to be something concrete.
Yes. And by the way, and nobody's questioning Matt Rose.
Yeah.
I mean, he's the example. He's the living example. Right. It's all those other folks, including the ones who came before Matt Rose.
Yeah.
And we're ahead of businesses here that shape that image you're talking about.
Where are they? Can we reach out to them? I'm sure we could come up with some names who those people are.
Well, the universe that Mr. Rose has asked us to explore is going to the executive round table. I understand that Robert is a member of that group. Maybe you could describe the composition.
He wasn't going to talk.
Well, because it's a closed group, for one thing. It is made up of current and former CEOs that are invited to be part of this group. I would say that there are more participating that are former CEOs than there are current CEOs, because we've lost a lot of Fort Worth resident type CEOs in the city compared to what was started many years ago. But there are individuals that are representative of this community. I would say it's not a good representation because it's not diverse.
What's the purpose of this?
It was started, I'd have to go back to Ann Richards how it all started.
Can,
so I don't want to go into that, but I'll discuss it with you some other time.
Yes, I think that'd be a good topic. We're getting a bit off topic here. Are there any other questions in terms of the leadership training itself that Estrus or Fernando could answer? Nope.
We'll provide additional information in response to your question.
Thank you. Yes, Charles.
So we're asking all of us to give at least three names.
Yes.
Yes.
And if you need name, address.
Yes.
Whatever you can provide.
Phone number and email.
Okay.
And you've got.
Is there anything in that training once they leave there, what they're going to do if they have lots of employees? What's their takeaway or homework to do, but who they represent?
I would say that would be mostly determined by them as individuals and their experience in this process. A significant part will be engaging them around practices to help facilitate or extend that kind of engagement that advances racial and cultural equity beyond the space of our time to their community groups, to their businesses. So that's part of the intent and the hope.
Anything else? Okay, we're going to move on to item agenda number 7. That's briefing on powers and duties of the Human Relations Commission. And we'd like to invite Chris Trout to come and give us his presentation. We thank you ahead of time. And I believe that can be found under tab 2, the brown tab.
I appreciate the thanks in advance, but I don't always get thanks afterwards.
I'll thank you again afterwards as well.
Appreciate it. Thank you. First off, can everyone hear me all right?
Okay. Can you get a little closer? Because I'm just getting old. I'm sorry.
Well, so am I. All right. My name is Chris Trout. I'm with the City Attorney's Office. I'm the Senior Assistant City Attorney. I've been with the City Attorney's Office since June of 2011, as mentioned, the PowerPoint that I'll be going over is at tab 2 in your packet. tell you is, first off, what topics we're going to cover today. We'll talk a little bit about the history of the Human Relations Commission, also known as the HRC. We're going to talk about the applicable city ordinances. We're going to talk about the HRC as a FEPA, a Fair Employment Practice Agency. We're going to talk about the Human Relations Commission as a Fair Housing Assistance Program, or a FAP. We're going to talk about the powers and duties and authority of the Human Relations Commission. And finally, we're going to talk about the Human Relations Unit and its relationship with the Human Relations Commission. In the PowerPoint presentation, there's a fair amount of historical information about the HRC, and I thank Angie Rush for providing much of that information. I'm not going to go into great detail about that. I'll leave it for your edification as you read the PowerPoint or look through the PowerPoint. But basically, more than 50 years ago, back in 1967, the city of Fort Worth and the community saw a need for a body to help the city of Fort Worth and its citizens and issues of discrimination in the community. So that was in 1967. So what I would like to do is skip ahead 50 years till the present and tell you where we are right now. This is the current state of the city's ordinance with respect to anti-discrimination. And it reads, "It is hereby declared to be public policy of the city that all of its residents and persons subject to its jurisdiction should enjoy equal freedom to pursue their aspirations, and that discrimination against any individual or groups because of race, creed, color, sex, religion, disability, age, national origin, familial status, sexual orientation, transgender, gender identity, or gender expression is detrimental to the peace, progress, and welfare of the city." Now, what you'll see as you read that list of protected classes is that the city's ordinance protects more classes of individuals than federal or state law does. You also may be interested to know that when the ordinance was passed, there was also a public policy declaration that came out, that was passed along with it, that said all the residents and persons subject to the jurisdiction of the city of Fort Worth should be free from any types of discrimination based on those classes, which originally the list was much shorter. Its list has grown longer as things have developed, as community has developed in the past 50 years. But it's important to note, I think, that the city of Fort Worth was one of the first cities in Texas to adopt its own anti-discrimination ordinance. So, in 1967, City of Fort Worth established what is now known as the Human Relations Commission. Back then it was known as the Commission on Community Relations. As I said, that was in 1967, more than 50 years ago. And the purpose stated at that time was to advise and consult with the City Council and City Manager regarding matters involving discrimination, and to recommend to the City Council measures designed to eliminate discrimination and prejudice, and promote and encourage communication in the community in the interest of bettering community relations. The HRC was our Commission on Human Relations at the time, what we now call the HRC, was also tasked with holding monthly meetings to hear citizen concerns regarding discrimination and have regular meetings to receive that information. Now, to this day, the Human Relations Commission carries out that function by having monthly meetings. Their meetings are held on the first Monday of each month now. And members of the commission, there's 11 of them, they serve as the eyes and ears of the community to bring to the commissioners matters of discrimination, prejudice, and other issues in the community that are troubling. And the entire commission, in an open meeting, discusses those concerns that are brought to their attention, either by citizens or by the commissioners themselves or by the members of the Human Relations Unit, which we'll talk about in a bit. And one of the things the Human Relations Committee does, which again we'll also talk about later, is it makes fact-finding decisions in fair housing cases. Now, as I said, the original ordinance passed back in the 1960s was changed over the years. In 2000,
Additional protected classes were added, including sexual orientation. And in 2009, the ordinance was again revised to include transgender, gender identity, and gender expression. In fact, the ordinance, if you look through the ordinance, you'll see it's been amended 6 times since it was passed in 1967. Now let's talk about the commission itself. There are 11 commissioners appointed by the City Council to the Human Relations Commission. They are appointed at large, and they can serve 3 consecutive 2-year terms. They serve as volunteers. They are not given any compensation. And in terms of the membership of the commission, under the city code, it provides that as nearly as is reasonably possible, the membership of the Human Relations Commission shall be fairly representative of the population of the city. Well, that is up to the City Council to determine how that is accomplished. Currently, these are the commissioners in the Human Relations Commission. There's one place vacant, place 9, and the chair right now is Eva Bonilla. And it's important to note, like I said before, that the commissioners are all appointed on an at-large basis. That is, their place number does not correspond to any district number within the city council. A lot of boards and commissions within the city do correspond to the districts of the council members. The Human Relations Commission does not. They are all tasked with representing the community as a whole. As I said, the commission meets on the first Monday of each month over at the Hazel Harvey Peace Center for Neighborhoods. The Human Relations Commission has 5 standing committees. 3 of them have been in place for a long time, 2 are new. The executive committee is composed of the officers, the chairs of the standing committees, and the media past chair, and their job is to provide oversight of the commission. The employment committee is comprised of HRC commissioners, and they are responsible for addressing matters involving fair employment practices and discrimination in employment. The housing committee is also composed of HRC commissioners, and is responsible for those areas of the commission and work with the human relations unit related to fair housing. As I said, the committee also serves as a hearing panel when requested to make fact findings in fair housing cases. 2 newer standing committees are the Mayor's Committee on Persons with Disabilities, and that is comprised of 11 citizen volunteers. These are not commissioner appointments. And those members of the Mayor's Committee on Persons with Disabilities, they're appointed by the Mayor's Office and with input from the HRC. Now, the purpose of that committee is to ensure that all persons with disabilities have full access and opportunity in life to the facilities and services and the enjoyment of life that those who are not, who do not have a disability enjoy. Also new as a standing committee is the Diversity and Inclusion Committee. And that committee is comprised of 23 city employees. Each city department appoints a representative, and the purpose of that committee is to promote a greater understanding of diversity and inclusion within the employee groups in the city of Fort Worth. Powers and duties of the HRC. The HRC is a creation of the city of Fort Worth, city council. Powers and authority of the HRC is solely within the discretion of the city council. The HRC only has those powers that are granted by ordinance to the commission. Only the city council can add to or take away from those powers and authority. And those powers and purposes are found in City Code section 17.18. And they read as follows. The Human Relations Commission shall have the following duties. 1, to advise and consult with the City Council and the City Manager on matters involving discrimination based on age, race, color, sex, religion, disability, national origin, familial status, sexual orientation, transgender, gender identity, or gender expression. It's the same list of protected classes that's in the ordinance. Secondly, the HRC is empowered to recommend to the City Council and the City Manager measures designed to eliminate prejudice and discrimination in the community. And thirdly, the Commission is authorized to promote and encourage communication between and cooperation of all groups in veteran community relations. So, advise and consult with the council, recommend measures to the council, and promote and encourage communication within the community. That is, in a nutshell, the purpose and powers of the HRC. Separate from the HRC is the Human Relations Unit. And that, and the commission is supported by the Human Relations Unit. The administrator of that unit is Andy Rush. And that unit is really part of the city manager's office. It includes a team of 14 investigators, intake specialists, and support staff. And you'll see here, the Human Relations Unit deals with enforcement issues, employment, fair housing practices, community engagement and outreach, getting the word out to the community, listening to the community, and also ADA compliance, the American Disabilities Act compliance. So now, the enforcement powers or duties of the HRU, those people who do the work, hit where the rubber hits the road, as they say, they have the authority to enforce laws and conduct investigations regarding discrimination in the areas of housing, employment, and public accommodations. As I said before, the Human Relations Unit is a FEPA, a Fair Employment Practices Agency. The HRU operates much like the EEOC does. People are probably familiar with how the EEOC operates to help ensure equal employment opportunity throughout the country. The HRU operates as a smaller version of the EEOC, investigating, trying to conciliate complaints of discrimination in the workplace. The HRU is also a Fair Housing Assistance Program, or a FAP. The HRU operates under a contract with the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development, HUD, to investigate and resolve fair housing complaints. The HRU also operates under a contract with the EEOC to investigate fair employment cases. The HRU includes a staff of investigators and support personnel who receive complaints, work towards conciliation with the parties, that is trying to resolve the issues that are presented to them, and conduct investigations and issue a determination of cause and take that forward if conciliation cannot be reached. Now, with respect to housing, the Federal Fair Housing Act and other federal laws prohibit housing discrimination based on race, color, sex, religion, national origin, familial status, that is pregnant women and children under the age of 18, and disability, and that's all that's defined in the Fair Housing Act. City's Fair Housing Ordinance goes even further than that and also protects more classes of people, including sexual orientation, gender identity, gender expression, and transgender. These fair housing laws cover almost all types of housing transactions you can imagine. Sales, leasing, private homes, apartment complexes, duplexes, whatever you can imagine, including also mortgage transactions and financial transactions related to the acquisition of real estate. So basically, anyone who is treated differently because of their protected class, as identified either in the Fair Housing Act or in the ordinance, would have a claim that they could bring to the HRU as a violation of the Fair Housing Act. And the HRU would investigate that and take action. So, those investigations by city ordinance, that is City Code Section 1792C, the HRU, that is the administrator of the HRU, has the power to issue subpoenas for documents and testimony. Now, this authority comes from the authority granted to the city and the city manager in the city's charter. So that authority is then delegated to the HRU administrator. Non-compliance with a subpoena issued by the HRU administrator is punishable by contempt. That's limited to a $500 a day fine. Can't put people in jail. The HRU administrator can issue subpoenas only in fair housing investigations, not in employment matters, and not in ADA compliance matters or public accommodations. The HRC itself, commissioners, are not given the authority to issue subpoenas. It's only the HRU administrator. And again, not in employment and not in public accommodations complaints, only in fair housing investigations.
city's role and the HRU's role in favor of fair housing investigations. If the HRU, the unit, finds cause to believe that legal discrimination has occurred, that issue can then be presented to and determined by a three-person panel of HRC commissioners. That is, if both sides agree to that process. Either side, either the complainant or what we call a respondent, that is the person who's alleged to have conducted the discrimination, either party can say, no, I want to go to district court, have this decided in a lawsuit, and that they can handle it that way. If both sides agree, then three members of the commission will serve as a panel to determine whether a discrimination has occurred. The panel gives evidence and renders a decision, either as cause for discrimination or no cause. And those members who sit on that panel are members of the commission who serve on the standing committee for housing. If cause is determined, then that issue can be litigated later in the court. Well, I will tell you, that doesn't happen very often. There's only been one time in the 7 years or so that I have been here that we have had an HRC panel determine a fair housing case. This doesn't happen that often because of the efforts of the HRU in resolving matters before they get that far. They're resolving matters to everyone's satisfaction. And I'll tell you that either in employment cases or housing cases, if a matter is going to be resolved, you might find that the employer, or let's say the landlord, is going to change the policy, agrees to change the policy, or pays the complainant some money. But almost always, and this is the most important part, I think, of this, is that the HRU insists that the employer or the landlord or whoever's accused of discrimination undergo training that is sanctioned by the HRU and sometimes presented by people in the HRU to make sure that these kind of practices don't happen again. So then we can talk about employment cases. Are you all familiar with the federal laws such as Title VII, the Americans with Disabilities Act, also the Age Discrimination and Employment Act? Those federal laws protect people from discrimination, that is, difference in treatment based on their race, color, sex, religion, national origin, age, if you're over 40, and disabilities. Again, the city's employment ordinance goes even further and protects discrimination based on sexual orientation, gender identity, gender expression, and transgender. So those are broader than the federal or state statutes. And simply said, an employer cannot base a decision to hire, fire, promote, or demote a person based on any of those protected classes. Now what the HRU does in those cases is conduct their investigation, determine whether cause exists to believe that discrimination has occurred. If cause is found, then they'll try to resolve the matter. If they can't resolve the matter, then it will usually go over to the EEOC for further action. And the EEOC can then decide whether to file a lawsuit against the employer for discrimination, and then take it from there. Now, the HRU also deals with issues of public accommodations. The city has a public accommodation ordinance, section 17.48 of the city code, that makes it unlawful for any business, any place of business, to deny advantages, facilities, or services offered to the general public to anyone because of that person's race, color, sex, religion, national origin, age, disability, sexual orientation, gender identity, gender expression, and transgender. Those same protected classes you'll see repeated in housing, employment, and here in the public accommodations as well. And this addresses the restaurant who says certain people cannot eat here or has different facilities for different classes of people. That is prohibited by the ordinance. And also state federal law. The HRU and the HRC do more than just conduct investigations and meetings and things like that. They also reach out to the community. So in addition to the enforcement efforts, the Human Relations Unit is also involved in many community engagement and outreach activities. And I've listed a few of these up on the board here. They present the Movies That Matter that are every quarter or so, every couple of months?
Maybe? Bi-monthly.
All right. And if you've ever been to see one of those presentations, it's very very, very engaging and very enlightening, and it's very well received by the community. They participate in community events and parades and get-togethers. They have presentations to various community groups, and they handle workshops as well, dealing with issues of discrimination and fair housing and how to treat people. Now, my final substantive slide deals with ADA compliance. Now, recently, the city's ADA coordinator responsibilities have been brought under the umbrella of the Human Relations Unit. And as you know, you probably know, the Americans with Disabilities Act requires that municipalities designate an ADA coordinator to oversee and coordinate ADA compliance, including the development, implementation, and oversight of an ADA transition plan. Now, a lot of that has to deal with both employment issues and the facilities of the city-owned facilities, their accessibility for persons with disabilities. As I said, that's the end of the substance of my presentation. I certainly would be happy to entertain any questions anyone has.
Before the questions, I want to thank you. Let's go.
Just thank you also for your presentation.
I was fishing for thank you.
Question is that I know it said that you guys have been responding to and updating the city manager and the city council, correct, in regard to issues with discrimination throughout the years?
Yes, that is a function of the Human Relations Commission. Yes.
Is there anything as far as written documentation of those conversations? I'm not saying that no one's doing anything. I'm just curious if there are patterns that were occurring throughout that are not new, which we would all contend might be so. And then, you know, is there something, I think part of that, how you guys have been structured, because it seems like we've been tasked with similar responsibilities. What have you found that has been successful and how you guys have been set up, and what has not been successful as far as the recommendations that you have made to the city?
Okay.
I know those are and it doesn't need to be answered right now, but in the presentation, there's some similarities in what we're tasked for and what you're tasked for.
Sure.
And I think there's opportunity to learn from one another so that we clearly understand not just this year, but also and what we've learned this year, but hearing from you guys from the patterns and trends that you've seen too. Would that be possible?
I'm sure that would. I'll defer that to Angie to answer.
They submit every board and commission is required to submit an annual report, so they do submit an annual report to the mayor and council. They also make one-off recommendations. So for example, they did make a recommendation that the city join the SB4 lawsuit. And there's a recommendation another one that's coming up. We also have several recommendations coming up from the Mayor's Committee on Persons with Disabilities that will be submitted to council. Now, if the question is, what happens then?
No, I think my question particularly is about what has been looked at as recommendations. As far as what has been discussed, and are there similarities? I'm going to assume there have been, and what the HRC has had in conversations and recommendations, and what this particular task force has heard as we're preparing to make recommendations.
I think if they
can we get that information?
Yeah, I can provide it. The one that comes to mind off the top of my head is it has to do with source of income. We did discuss that, we looked at to see how Austin was faring with source of income as a protected class, because that has to do with vouchers and the availability of housing. There is some overlap there.
Is there the ability then, possibly, I know because that's a lot of information, but looking at these committees of recommendations maybe that have already been done with criminal justice, economic development, education, health, housing, and transportation to give us an indication?
I can tell you I have not seen anything that's come out on health, economic development, criminal justice, there was some. there was some request for meetings with the chief about, 2 years ago. And we also look at their hiring. HR gives presentations on diversity in hiring. We've had police and fire come and give presentations on their hiring, and they've made recommendations to police, like maybe you should try other recruitment practices. Esther, you've been there for some of it, I'm trying to think.
If you have the recommendations, we just like to see them.
Yeah.
That's it.
Thank you. It's great work. I just would like to see what has been documented that have been recommendations and maybe these particular areas that we're in committees for, so that we're aware of them and we can learn.
Yeah, one of the things to remember is that Human Relations Commission meets as a public entity, so it follows the Open Meetings Act, and nothing can be done by the commission unless that is voted upon and by a majority vote agreed upon at an open meeting. So the communication that occurs between the commission and the city council is limited by that, because they can't just get together and have a chat about things. So you have resolutions going back and forth, maybe from the commission to the city council saying, here's something we think you should take a look at, and I think we've had some of those over the years.
I think I'm just interested in them.
And then also if you have they addressed it or not addressed it, why? So they made a recommendation and they...
I can't tell you why. I mean, if it's submitted to council, that would be a council decision. But I can tell you what's been submitted.
I have a couple questions related. One, the charge is a little narrow, more narrow, I think, in some ways than our charge.
Right.
Overlaps, but is more narrow. One of the questions I have is, given it's an advisory group and noting it's a public, they have called the Public Meeting Rules, Public Act, does the council seek out this commission for advice on issues that come up, even outside of the scope? So I don't necessarily expect this right now, but for example, Jackie Craig arrest, SB4, other things, because again, to I think Terry's point, there's some overlap, or at least you would think there'd be some overlap, but then we look at what their definition is, it's narrower. The other question I have relates to the Diversity and Inclusion Committee that's made up of 23 city employees, where each department appoints a representative. Does that group interface at all with any other group, particularly with HR within the city? Because I think in some ways, that group, not knowing exactly what their discussions are, their city employees, that again, from some of the kind of common things we're talking about, change from within, if the leadership of the city has to walk the talk.
The Diversity and Inclusion Committee is brand new. They've had 2 meetings.
What sparked it?
There used to be an older committee called the Diversity Advisory Committee that there was like 6 or 7 people, and it just floundered and sort of petered out over the years. And so we decided, when they moved Mayor's Committee under HRC, they also moved that older Diversity Advisory Committee under HRC. And then we sat down and met with a group that was interested to come up with what are we going to look at, what are that we wanting to do. They're looking at everything from professional development to HR issues to just actually, right now their big push is to let people know that they're there and to celebrate the diversity of the workforce, because we have not done that. We've had groups, like we've had the MLK group have an event, but we want to bring everyone together and celebrate all their diversities. So they really are just hitting the ground. They've already got a work plan for almost to the end of this year, and the committees are starting to meet. So they're actually, I expect good work out of them, because they are so engaged, and it's a very, very diverse group. The previous group was not so diverse, looked a lot like me. So this is a much improvement. over to what it was. And much smaller, and then we've had some departments that may have had, at the time, two or three individuals from that department, none from other departments.
And as a standing committee, that diversity and inclusion committee would report to the commission itself at monthly meetings.
One quick question. And I don't need an answer tonight, but you said there have been six changes to the ordinance over the past 50 years?
Yes.
And I know some of them obviously were good changes because they added to protected classes. Are there any changes made to the ordinance that weaken this commission?
Not that come to mind. I don't recall all six of them, but I think they generally do add classes, you know, over time. Especially sexual orientation, transgender.
What was the purpose, or why was the committee established in 1967?
Well, if you think about what was going on in the 60s, and Fort Worth was part of a realization, I think, in various communities that there were racial issues that needed to be addressed and needed to be addressed in an organized way. So that's my understanding of why the commission.
I already knew the answer because that was the first year of voluntary integration in Fort Worth.
That's right.
But also, we're in the same spot 50 years later.
But there was also a major demonstration outside of City Hall by black citizens who sat down on the lawn outside of City Hall, which sparked.
Yeah, so it's a similar condition in that situation 50 years later.
Yeah. So God willing, in another 50 years, we won't ask that question, what happened in 2017-18?
May I ask another question?
Yeah, I'm just going to point out the photograph Mr. Shannon's real referred to is up there. Under your part. Okay,
so I was right.
Yes, indeed.
Okay, thank you. Good to hear that every now
and then. Another question, since it's not noted here, and the city council has the membership to be fairly representative of the population of the city. So, off the commission that exists right now, how many African Americans?
We had two. Until recently, we had a resignation, so I'm looking for another African American, and we have. I can break that all the different information down and provide it.
Okay, so vacant place 9 is African American.
Yes.
Okay.
That's what I'm looking for. Okay. Yes.
Apparently, we don't have any Asians or Muslims on here.
Yeah,
we've had.
We've had.
I'm sorry. Geographical areas does not come into play in this. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Robert, you
have
a question?
HRU reports to the city manager's office, based on what I understand.
Yes.
HRC advises the city council.
Yes.
How do they interact? What kind of reporting does HRU do to the commission?
And once again, we're just referring to this brush for that because she's the one who coordinates those efforts.
Yeah, I actually do an administrative report every session, let them know what's going on with the human relations unit, and vice versa. I go back and have at staff meetings and we talk about what's going on at the commission. I am also I am the only city employee that's evaluated by a commission. I'm evaluated by the city manager's office and by the commission. So we report back and forth. Whatever they want to do, I have to try to assist them in doing that. Like if they want a recommendation, I'll have to help prepare that recommendation. So it's constant. I basically email exchange often with most of the members. And like when Estrus is on there, he can attest, it's just constant phone calls back and forth talking, what do we need to do, where are we going?
Is there anything you would like to see to strengthen the commission?
No, I think the commission works well as is.
You sure?
Yeah.
Arturo?
As a legal advisor, I think I would say that, yes.
Member?
Could it take on police issues? Should it?
Well, it depends on what you mean by police issues.
Discrimination within the police department and discrimination by the police department.
Discrimination within the police department, within its own employees, and in the community. The couple of things that are peculiar with this police department is that they operate under the civil service laws, which is chapter 143 of the local government code. And there are certain protections that exist for things like police officers or firefighters, employment records, and disciplinary matters, or matters that don't rise to the level of discipline. Matters that don't rise to the level of discipline are confidential by law. That's very clearly stated in chapter 143. So to give people access to that information in order to look and see how is discipline meted out by a police chief, let's say, or what matters are considered and what aren't, that's problematic because of those confidentiality provisions that are by law that we have to abide by.
Has the commission ever recommended a citizen review board?
Well, that's kind of what I'm talking about. The citizens review board would have those same restrictions upon it, okay. Confidentiality of that's in the state law.
Maybe I could ask that question a little differently. If a citizen believes they have been discriminated against by the police department, where do they go with that? Do they go to the HRC? Do they go to the police department? How is that handled?
They wouldn't go necessarily to the HRC, because if they are seeking relief from that, they could talk to a city council member or end up filing a lawsuit
against
civil rights violation, yes, against the city and or against the police officers involved. And one thing I forgot to mention, on the issue of discrimination within the employment of the police department, any police department employee feels like they have been a victim of discrimination, can file a charge to the EEOC and proceed through that agency to seek redress of their situation.
They can't go through you?
No. To me personally or the HRC?
HRC.
They wouldn't go through the HRU because the Human Relations Unit does not deal with employment issues involving city employees.
We can take the complaint, but then we defer it because we do not want there to be a conflict of interest. We don't want that individual to think that we're going to just side. So what we do is we defer it to the EEOC.
Okay. And so, just so that you know, the police department, as every city department, prohibits discrimination. There's state law against racial profiling. And so if there's a complaint of that, that does go from police, it goes to the internal affairs unit, and they investigate it from the police perspective. So you can have your civil rights lawsuit, because certainly discrimination would be a civil rights violation, but if you're looking for an internal administrative procedure, it would go through the police department.
Any other questions? Well, for a third time, thank you very much. I really appreciate it.
Just a one quick comment, and Chris, excellent job as always, and Angie. It's about your question, Bob Ray. I think that has there been changes in the ordinance? If we're looking at what HRC does and what it has done, you're looking for change. It's not just the ordinance. I think what would help us see possibilities of that particular body is to look at structural changes in the HRC from the time Rosa chaired through when I chaired it to now. When Rosa and I chaired it, was a city department with a department director with a different budget than what they have now. So you can look at those structural changes in positions, and that will tell you about the capacity, one story about the capacity of the commission.
So the commission has less influence with the council than it does now?
It's a different, totally different structure. Before 2010, we were part of the community relations. We had neighborhoods under us. We had communications under us. We had human relations under us. We had the mayor's committee at that time and the youth advisory board. During the downturn, they cut a significant part of it. They cut the community health piece. They said that was a county function. They moved the early childhood learning to libraries. They pulled neighborhoods out. and they became an office. We were no longer a department.
Who is
now,
they? Who is they? I'm sorry.
Oh, I'm sorry. It's the city manager's office, executive management, made those decisions. We do function a little bit like a department. Like I go to department head meetings and such, but we do not have the resources that a larger department has. The majority of our funding in human relations comes from our grants, our contractual reimbursements from HUD and EEOC. The majority of our operating budget is that, and therefore it's limited to what we can do. It has to be housing related, it has to be employment. So there are definitely some limits on our funding, absolutely.
Can we get, like in a, just a line of the changes, some type of documentation that we can see the patterns and trends and how it's been adjusted like in 10 years?
In 10 years, okay.
Because you're talking about, well, more than 10 years, because we're talking about the downturn, I'm assuming you're referring to 2008.
Yeah, I've been with them, I've actually been a part of this for 17 years.
Okay, so
I can,
maybe the past 17 years.
I can do that. I did the budget too, so I can figure that out.
There's a line so we can say this, that, cut, da da da. That would be very helpful.
All right, well, thank you very much. We're now going to move on to the committee reports. I know that Ty had to leave, so Chief Krause is going to give us a report. And I'm just going before it is even. Cass mentioned that the law department has said that because the committee hasn't addressed the issues of the officer being indicted, that we cannot bring this up at this meeting, but can be put onto the agenda for the future. Is that correct, Fernando?
Yes, sir.
That's correct.
I move that be on the agenda for the next meeting.
Second.
Any objections? So moved. Chief.
Hi. So our last meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee was February 28th. We had two other meetings that had to be canceled because of scheduling conflicts since that time. At the last meeting, we went over several internal disparities within the police department. Specifically specialized units and specialized detective offices that are underrepresented with minority officers. And we looked at why that may be the cause and what we can do about that. So we also looked at disparities regarding diversity of our field training officers. And data sources, both internal with policy and with the personnel records to show those diversity, that lack of diversity in some of those units. We also looked at certain units that are very diverse within the police department, and we questioned why they had more participation than some of the other units.
And we're also going to looking at the city marshal and the municipal courts. That falls under the purview of criminal justice. And have we heard back from the sheriff? This is the county seat, Fort Worth, and he needs to have a seat here so we can see where his head is. Have we sent out invitations to him?
We have invited the sheriff on multiple occasions and has used various means to reach him.
Is anyone here from the media? Can someone please go ask him why he hasn't responded? Because this is getting laborious now.
Okay.
I don't bite my tongue. This is getting laborious. He's been asked. He should be here by now. This is ridiculous. If Sharon Wilson can come, he can come.
Noted. Thank you. Yes.
Just one of the chief crafts we talked about, consistency and training.
Yes, sir.
In the field.
Consistency in the field training, and we also looked at, in the earlier meeting, we looked at our training regimen from the recruit training to the field training and then the inserts training.
responsibilities of early recruitment. We talked about earlier, we talked about recruitment too.
Yes, sir. And recruitment is, if we can get the recruitment piece bigger, better, to more match the diversity in our city, that would solve a lot of the internal disparities.
What about internal affairs? Has anything been discussed with internal affairs?
That is on the agenda for the next, for our next meeting. On Monday, hopefully that'll be part of it, that Ty did request some information on the last 2 years worth of administrative investigations that we're going to go over.
I'm specifically concerned also about the loop closure. When you get a call, how does that, what is the process to get that responded to close the loop up?
I was going to say, I was at that meeting, it was a productive meeting. I was just wondering, because I heard, I don't know if it's true, is Valerie Washington no longer over the police department?
That's correct. That is correct.
Have you been given a reason why?
The city manager, week before last, announced a reorganization of the city manager's office with respect to the departments that report to different assistant city managers. And one of the organizational changes was to move the police department from the purview of Valerie Washington to the purview of Jay Choppa. So Chief Fitzgerald now reports to Mr. Choppa.
Did the city manager, I mean, I haven't heard this publicly, did the city manager explain why he made that move?
He made a variety of changes. For example, three of the departments reporting to me were reassigned and three others were assigned to me. And he made similar changes with respect to all four of the assistant city managers. They're widespread for the purposes of promoting more horizontal management, whereby it would be less consequential who the assistant city manager happens to be. Department heads run their departments. The city manager's office, the city manager, and the four assistant city managers collectively make decisions that affect the entirety of the organization.
But he didn't say why.
I don't know why specifically he reassigned the police department. He intended to make widespread changes. And as it happens, the police department was one of the many departments that shifted to. Probably half the city departments shifted from one assistant city manager to another. And that happened to be one of them.
Can we get a current or job?
Sure. You have to do it.
Thank you.
I'm a visual person.
Any other questions for the? Thank you, Chief Grass, very much. Charles, economic development?
I believe we've met twice since we last reported to the full group, last meeting, last Wednesday. We've been doing a number of things. One of the more important ones, I think, is actually reviewing the current initiatives of the Economic Development Department, because they have a number of new initiatives that we are fully supportive of, but that many of them are in an early stage. We've also had input directly from Mr. Thornton, came to one of our meetings. I asked him directly what's the one thing in the area of economic development that he would recommend that we, as his task force, recommend to the city council. He said to fund the strategic plan. That the big 600-page document that got introduced to the council 2 months ago, or whatever it was. So it sort of, in my mind anyway, brings up that seems like a very legitimate thing. You've invested in this consultant report to tell you where to go with economic development. You need to follow through with it. He said there's some obligations on the private side. And he says, as the Fort Worth Chamber, they're stepping up to fund their piece of it. I think you're looking at the council to do the same thing. It's I'm reminded that we've had the same conversation with respect to transportation. We've had the same conversation with respect to the 3E report in the police department. These are prior recommendations that have been made, but they largely have not been implemented. So we don't want to be in that same spot, right?
Absolutely.
So just something to keep in mind as we move forward.
Thank you. Any questions? Robert?
Bob is traveling, so business week's not here. Our meeting, we've had one, we're starting to hear from our subject matter experts. We have another one on Thursday, as we're refining, and these subject matter experts are the ones related to the draft disparities that we've identified as a committee. So that process will continue. We have at least four more individuals identified that we need to hear from before we can really solidify our draft report.
Questions? Thank you. Yolanda's not here. Miriam?
Sure. I wasn't at that last meeting, but we do have notes if you want to.
Yeah, I can report on it. Yeah, at our last meeting, we met with subject matter expert Brady O'Quinn, who owns Project Portward. A lot of our last discussion was focused around nutrition education, food access, food deserts in Fort Worth. And then something that came out of that specific conversation was where health and wellness fall within the strategic plan in the City of Fort Worth comprehensive plans. And so that is one of the action items to look at for between now and our next meeting. We did kind of narrow down and identify the top health disparities that we're kind of going to focus on: infant mortality, obesity, hypertension, diabetes, and then the fifth one just being overall access to care. And so, you know, there's a couple of different programs that the subject matter expert recommended, and we will be looking further into those. But like I said, the next big thing that we're looking at is where does health and wellness fall within the city's plan.
Thank you very much. Any questions? Thank you. Katie, housing?
Following our all-day work session, we discovered it was incredibly helpful to meet with members of the other subcommittees because there's so much intersectionality in housing and economic development, housing and criminal justice. And so we are having a joint meeting tomorrow with the three committees. And we're hoping we can tease out areas that perhaps economic development can start focusing on so that housing can stay more tightly focused on issues. Affordable housing is a huge issue, and particularly is now with this housing bubble, because landlords and they don't need vouchers, they don't need to, there's no incentive. Getting people out of homelessness. The biggest cause of homelessness is people fall behind on rent and are evicted. The biggest predictor of being homeless is a previous incident of homelessness. So economic development is a huge part, as is transportation. So having us, the three of us, come together to talk, I think, will be incredibly productive and allow us to focus more clearly on areas that they can make recommendations on and we can make recommendations on effectively. Do you want to add anything to that, Jennifer?
No. I think you got it.
Yeah. Terrific. Thank you. We look forward to hearing what the three committees talk about and their conclusions.
Great idea.
Transportation. Jennifer, would you like to?
Well, I would say Judy and I and Arthur were at the last meeting 2 weeks ago, maybe almost, and we're having another meeting this week. Like, a lot of groups still have been gathering a lot of information. We had a great team from the city presenting to us last meeting around conditions and transportation related to streets, sidewalks, all those, the infrastructure piece, and really digging into some of the data. So I think we're working towards the possibilities of, you know, getting towards those actual recommendations and things that are actionable.
Tech's been a great resource.
I'm sorry, but we have a transportation committee with the forward chamber, and we've been invited to participate in that. We're going to start meeting every 2 weeks. We do have a meeting on Wednesday at 3:00. And somebody from the transportation committee, if y'all would like to participate, you know, we'd love to have one of y'all there.
Well, I have to say, before this meeting, we had at 4:00 a meeting with the city staff and the chairs of the subcommittees to go over some of the interim reports and what is going on. And I know all of us want to thank each and every one of you who is on a committee and who are chairing the committees for all this great work that you guys are doing. And on behalf of all the co-chairs, we also want to thank the city staff for everything they're doing in helping guide and be a resource to the committees. What you are all, what we're all doing here in these subcommittees is definitely going to influence the future of Fort Worth. So thank you all very much. If there's no further on that, we'll move to future meetings. Leave that to Fernando.
On your agenda, you have information about upcoming meetings. Your next regular meeting is scheduled for Monday, April 16th, the third Monday of the month. And as we indicated to the committee chairs at the 4 o'clock meeting, it's important for the task force to complete work on its interim report at that April 16th meeting. We are asking all the committees to submit their information about the extent of disparities pertaining to their topic and the cause of those disparities by Wednesday, April 11th, so that we can disseminate that information, if possible, to the full task force in advance of your April 16th meeting. So our time frame is short for completing the initial work of the task force committees in identifying those disparities and the causes behind them. Thereby allowing the full task force to complete the interim report at that next meeting on April 16th. We have much work to do between now and then. The interim report is scheduled to go to the City Council on Tuesday, May 1st, at their regular work session at 3 o'clock. We would encourage all task force members to be present as a show of solidarity. We're asking the 4 co-chairs to share responsibility for presenting the report to the full council at that time. I don't think I can overstress the importance of having complete and accurate and objective data about disparities to reinforce the credibility of this task force. Want to echo the remarks of the presiding chair about the great work being done by the committees, because the committee work really lies at the heart of what this task force is doing. We appreciate your leadership.
Thank you. Are there any closing remarks from co-chair? Then I just want to once again extend personally not only my thanks to our thanks, and you got an email about a Passover Seder that I'm putting on, a citywide Passover Seder for the entire community. And please, if you'd like to come, it's not too late, just let me know, and we'll be happy to host you. Once again, thank you very much, and we're adjourned.